We want to give you some information here. Very serious information. As we start our Black History Month from now. You know, we don't come out of the blackness still, but there are certain times when we give you more black information than certain times. You understand? Because, you know, we have to put in this and put in that. Sometimes we put in this and sometimes we put in that. But straight up, it's the next month. Next month, you better buy up enough cassette between Andrea Williams and Muta Baroka program. Enough cassette. But TDK should have paid me Andrea the Rasta. I tell you, we should have get some money off of TDK. Yes. Because we make TDK cassette sell more than we usually sell. Okay, we want to talk about Spain 1492. Spain in 1492. Now, this is information. This is what they never tell you in a history class. Alright? This is what they did not tell you in history class. We want to present what they never tell you in history class. Okay. The Spanish monarchs, Ferdinand and Isabella, who sent Columbus to the Americas, ruled a feudal kingdom called Aragon and Castile. The nobility, about 2% of the population, owned 95% of the land. Almost all the rest of the people were poor peasants. No, we're talking about Europe here. We're talking about Europe here now. Because we contend that the stagnation of African development came because of the invasion of the Arabs and the Europe and Europeans on the African continent. And people look on Africa right now and say Africa is not technologically advanced, is not capable to run them country, is always in war and is always in coups and all these things. But we did not understand and we did not realize, a lot of us, that Europe went through worse than what Africa is going through at this moment. Apart from we now living in the situation and the conditions now that we can clearly define it in our lifetime, in our time. But there was a time in Europe, in medieval Europe, when the atrocities, the diseases, and the whole of feudalism that took place in Europe. One would never know if they never study European history. So, what am I saying this far? I am saying that Europe underdeveloped Africa. And there is a book named How Europe Underdeveloped Africa by Walter Rodney. You know, see? So we have said to you that we declare that it is because of the invasion of Europeans and Arabs inside of Africa. Why Africa development seemed to be so stagnant, seemed to be so colonialistic and neo-colonialistic. Because we know that every set of people, every continent went through an age and a process of stagnation. And the difference between European stagnation and African stagnation is that the Europeans was not prevented from moving forward by invaders. Because when Hannibal and the Moors went into Europe, it was not to colonize Europe or stagnate development of any people. But it is proven and can be proven that the Moors and Hannibal did contribute to the development scientifically, intellectually, and culturally to the progress of Europe. So there was no period in European history where invaders actually stagnated European development. But what we see in Africa is a different case. When Africa was on its way to development, we had the Arabs invasion and they spent 1,000 years there. Even Egypt, we've declared that Egypt, which is known as Kemet, was stagnated by the invasion of these people. And then we have the Europeans who came into Africa and stagnated the development of Africa. So we're not listening to nobody. We not make nobody sell we no craziness about Africans backward because we don't have no sense. Africa is technologically not advanced because of the invaders that invaded our land. while they progress, not because they are more intellectual or more capable of deciphering technological advancement, but because they were not what they call suppressed in their technological advance. So we go on to move on and we say now, we're talking about 1492 here. It is said now that 95% of the land, almost all the rest of the people, were poor peasants. The art of the ruling class was the Mesta, M-E-S-T-A, the association of sheep-owning noblemen. Their herds of 3 million crisscrossing northern Spain in search of grazing pastures were the art of the country's economy. See? That means that them was also sheep herders. They sold wool north to the growing merchant and artisan cities of the Dutch Netherlands. Our historian Hans Koenig sums up, quote, "This then is a very brief sketch of economics of Spain at the end of the 15th century. Half-starving peasants and noblemen holding enormous estates, townships, humble obedient to an aggressive monarchy and church. The country was crisscrossed by millions of hungry sheep, like a permanent plague of locusts. Wool was a national export, but the wool trade brought in diminishing returns, and the damage to the land began to cause repeated famines at home." Listen good enough, people. Famines at home. So, it's not only Africa, famine this day now. But famine was in Europe. And we can tell you now why, we can discuss why famine is so prevalent in Europe. People want to tell you it's an act of God, but we know there's no such thing as no act of God. Okay. This sank steadily into debt to the merchants and bankers who controlled trade and who brought their wool. They developed a desperate, constant, and increasing need for external plunder to hold their system together. During the 1400s, the Spanish crown refined a machinery of militarized religious orders who waged permanent warfare in the Moorish eras of southern Spain. We're going to read it again. During the 1400s, the Spanish crown refined a machinery of militarized religious orders who waged permanent warfare in the Moorish eras of southern Spain. Among the feudal classes, the eldest sons inherited estates and sheep. This left a large pool of desperate second sons to become the plundering soldiers of the Spanish crown. Like parasites, these conquistadors lived off a Moorish Spain. Now we must remember that the influence of the Moors in Spain was 700 years in Spain. It is the Moors that gave Spain its architectural designs, its culture, and its refinement. We know that now, based off of our historical evidences. Okay, the feudals justified this warfare with a fanatical Catholicism that called for holy war against foreign heathens and domestic heretics. God, they said, wanted them to kill and rob unbelievers. The church set up the infamous Spanish Inquisitions to seek out and kill those who opposed the dominant order. Listening to me? The church set up the infamous Spanish Inquisition. We have mentioned the Inquisition on this program many times. If you don't know what Inquisition is, go into your libraries, because they have more European books there than African history books. So you must can find a book on the Spanish Inquisition, started by this king and queen, Isabella, to get out the Jews and the Moors out of Spain. And we must mention here that the Moors, after getting out the Moors and the Jews, this Inquisition did spread all over Europe. Because you have also the French Inquisition. And for those of you who watch movies like me, There's a movie on the TV right now showing named Joan of Arc. Very historical movie, Joan of Arc. Very interesting to watch that movie to see how the church manipulate the political system. It's a serious thing. It's a serious, serious thing. In that movie, and in many movies like that, you will see how the church manipulated the political system to do whatsoever the church wanted them to do. So sometimes when we see political people moving, and we feel it's them, we have to watch the greater picture, which is the so-called divine picture. When you start to put a divine cloud over people, it is very difficult for them to establish what we call sensibility in their activity. Okay, so we go on now. Where are we? We say, the feudal justified their warfare with a fanatical Catholicism that called for holy war against foreign heathens and people who are referred to as pagans or heretics. God, they said, wanted them to kill and rob unbelievers. The church set up the infamous Spanish Inquisition to seek. Listen, you know, we're not going to read this again, you know. Oh, this is history that they never tell you. The church set up the infamous Spanish Inquisition to seek out and kill those who oppose the dominant order. Confessions were extracted, often after weeks in torture chambers. Then the confessed heretics were publicly burned at the stake in the marketplace in a ritual called auto da fe. Now, I have seen some of those, what you call, torture chambers that was used in medieval Europe. And I tell you, it's not lovely. It's not lovely. When they stretch you and all these things, it's not lovely. I have seen them with my own eyes, and I am telling you, it is not lovely. These torture chambers were built by the men of God. If the men of God build these torture chambers to torture people, to say that they are heretics. Heretics are the people them who is saying things that is not in line with the church order. Not in line with the church and say you are heretic. I know what they did now. They make it a public affair to burn heretics in the square, in the marketplaces. So people, they would leave this, the accused in the marketplace, tie them up on a post and burn them, and the people would stand there and read poetry, because you have people who's reading poems and singing songs and all these things while these things are happening, and the church fathers, the bishops and all these people sitting down and say, yes, it is the will of God that this must be done. In 1482, as the Spanish state expanded through warfare, the Spanish Inquisition came under the direct control of the crown. Thomas de Torquemada, Queen Isabella's personal priest, became its infamous chieftain. Now we must remember this name. Thomas, Queen Isabella's personal priest, became its infamous chieftain. In the decade before Columbus left Spain, thousands of people were burned at the stake. This is when talk about Africa is savage people, you know. These are people who are supposed to be civilized in the name of the Lord, putting people in the middle of them square and burning them and singing poetry and reading songs. Reading poetry and singing songs. Okay. In the year 1492, Ferdinand and Isabella finally conquered the last Muslim city in Spain. Queen Isabella signed the edict of expulsion, taking all wealth from Spain's 150,000 Jews and expelling them. And that same month, the conquistadors turned their hungry eyes westward. Isabella gave Columbus his sailing orders for the west. His orders were simple: to discover and acquire. He was to bring back pearls, precious stones, gold, silver, spices, and other things, and merchandise of whatever kind, name or description that may be. Quote, his three ships carried no cargo to trade for that wealth. Throughout the centuries that followed, Europeans justified their conquest by claiming their, quote, civilization, unquote, was inherently superior. But the Spanish realm, which said Columbus was in 1492, was one of the most intolerant, brutish, and reactionary societies in history. Its marketplaces, these are some serious things, you know. Its marketplaces that filled with the bitter smoke of people burnt at the stake. Listen to this alone. You know. This is not no, this is not where you call, like where you travel already, road, I smell jerk chicken, you know. These are the bodies of people being burnt, roasted in the marketplaces in the name of this Catholicism, the Inquisition. Its marketplaces were filled with the bitter smoke of people burnt at the stake, and its harbors were crammed with boats shipping thousands of persecuted Jews into exile. In the Europe of Columbus, rat-transmitted plagues swept through every generation. This is Europe we are talking about during Columbus' time. Rat-transmitted plagues swept through every generation. Less than 1 in 20 people in Western Europe could read. You hear that? So the illiteracy rate in Europe, you know, was high. Talking about Africa. We're talking about Africa. We're making a comparison here. We're talking about the underdevelopment of Africa. We're talking about the underdevelopment of Europe. We're talking about the development of Europe. And why is it that Europe could have developed so fast? And why is it that Africa is still stagnant? That's what we're talking about. So he said, half of the newborn never reached the age of 15. We're talking about the mortality rate here now. And bathing was considered a satanic practice. You hear that, Chris? This is Europe, you know. Bathing was considered a satanic practice. As a matter of fact, you know, it is known that when the Muslims, I will say this before on this program, when the Muslims used to bathe twice per day, they were carried and burnt at the stake. So they was practicing satanic worship because they bathed twice. Why would a man want to bathe two times a day? What him have to bathe? These people never bathed for months. And it is said that Queen Elizabeth I bathed only twice per year. And when she bathed, it was a scene. I mean, it was drama. Hairy, hairy. On the 14th day of the year of our Lord, Queen Elizabeth will take a bath. It's a serious thing. This is the continent of IRFM. We'll come back to it. And the Inquisition. Now we're talking about Spain and Europe and what was taking place in Europe during 1492 and backwards. And we're talking about the development and underdevelopment of Africa and the development and underdevelopment of Europe. We're just trying to balance the powers here, you know. We're trying to balance the powers here because we hear people talk all the while that how come Europeans so advanced and African them so backward? How come Africa so backward and people there Africa kill one another and all them things there? Well, we must understand that Europe went through worse than what Africa went through right now. But there was no one to prevent the development of Africa. But Africans have been prevented by Arabs, by Europeans, and we're still being prevented, but we are got through. Yes, so we're back to the reading here. In the Europe of Columbus, rat transmitted plague swept through every generation. Less than 1 in 20 people in Western Europe could read. Half of the newborn never reached the age of 15. Bathing was considered a satanic practice. All the acts of the conquistadors were justified by their fanatical Christianity. Columbus always described himself as the Christ bearer. He swore he was bringing the civilizing power of Christianity to new shores in preparation for the second coming of the Messiah. But any study of the Spanish conquest of the Americas revealed that the real fanaticism of Spain, upper class conquistadors, was their obsessive worship of gold. Of his last voyage, Columbus wrote, quote, "Gold is most excellent. Whoever possesses it may do what he wishes in the world." Unquote. This fetish for gold was an expression of a rotting feudal order being ripped at the seams by its own contradictions. The collapsing forces of European feudalism were trying to claw for a few decades more of life. And the rising new forces of Northern European capitalism were injecting unprecedented craving for wealth into human history. Serious thing. And after we do this link up, we're going to come back to more reasoning of what they didn't tell you in history class when them teaching you about history. Them don't tell you these things. This is the cutting edge. We're talking about 1492 and Columbus and them friend them. We're just trying to make a comparison here between things of Africa and things in Europe. And we do these things because we want the people them to know that it's useless to declare Africa as a non-entity, because we know different. And we want to make the people them know different. You see, Europe underdeveloped Africa in more ways, spiritually and economically, politically and socially. Whole heap of ways. You see, because what we understand and what we know is that whenever the Europeans enter any country with them, especially them religion, you find that the culture of the people becomes dormant, becomes null and void. So there's no space for cultural, indigenous cultural practices when Christianity, given to us by Europe, is in your country. There's no space for because indigenous practices of different African states is seen as heathenism and paganism. And whenever someone adopts Christianity, there's no space for his indigenous practice. And we see that everywhere Europeans go and implant these ideas and culture in the minds of the people. People will be living like angels, like when Christopher Columbus came to this part of the world, you know, in this part of the world, and him talk about the Taínos as people who was gentle, and even themselves right, that never before have they seen such calmness of spirit amongst people, yet still, them kill them off. We are saying that there is no space for your true identity in European Christianity, or Christianity for that matter, because whenever this religion is practiced amongst people in their land, they give up what they knew and what they understand to be their practice, their spiritual practice or religious belief. So, compare then those blessings enjoyed by Spaniards of prudence, genius, magnanimity, temperance, humanity and religion with those of the little men, meaning the native peoples, in whom you will scarcely find even vestige of humanity. This is a guy talking now. And Columbus did say, quote, they would make fine servants. With 50 men, we could subjugate them and make them do whatever we wanted. Christopher Columbus saying these things. All right, now. This is a man who sees himself as Christ bearer, you know. Genuinely believe in this concept, you know, this idea. So it's a no. No sign, but who also lack letters and preserve no monument of their history. This is the man they matter about, the people they in Arasta. This is a Spanish priest named Jean Jeans de Sepulveres. This is a priest I talk now about the natives, so-called natives. Compare then those blessings enjoyed by Spaniards of prudence, genius, magnanimity, temperance, humanity, and religion with those of the little men in whom you will scarcely find even vestiges of humanity, who not only possess no science, but who also lack letters and preserve no monuments of their history except certain vague and obscure reminiscence of some things on certain paintings. Neither do they have written laws, but barbaric institutions and customs. They do not even have private property. Listen to these people, Rasta. This is a priest attacking, you know, a Spanish priest attack about the people them when come find, you know. Him say, they do not even have private property. These people never believe in private property, you know. The land does not belong to man. It belongs to the earth. Man cannot own land. But now, in their culture, people own land, you know. So them say, no, it's barbaric. You know? How can we doubt that these people, so uncivilized, so barbaric, You know why them kind of people them barbaric? Because them already didn't have on any clothes. So uncivilized, so barbaric, contaminated with so many impieties and obscenities, have been justly conquered. See it? Them justly conquered the Tainos, where you call Arawaks. Well, them call them Tainos too. Quote, again, a next quote here now. In every story ever written about this voice, the reader not unnaturally is made to root for the three ships. Will they make it or won't they? But knowing what came after this voyage, I now find myself reading the log of those late days at sea with very different eyes. For me, they acquire the drama of a murderer coming ever closer to his unsuspecting victims. On his first voyage, Columbus had described the Taino people as the most gentle people on earth. This was to convince its sovereigns in Spain that conquering them would be easy. On his second voyage, he returned with 17 ships and 1,200 armed men to establish a settlement and conquer the lands. He was now officially, quote, governor of the New World. On his voyage, Columbus started to claim that major Indian tribes were brutal cannibals. This is a story that is written in your history books. We want to vanquish that lie that has been perpetuated in history books. One of the things that they tell us in history is that the cannibals, known as the Caribs, ate the Arawaks. That is why the Arawak population get less. But it's lie. Lie them telling on the Caribs. There's no evidence archaeologically or anthropologically that the Caribs were cannibals. Is the Spaniards kill half the Arawaks? It's not eat them get eaten. Lie them telling. So we want to dash away that mythology that has been perpetuated amongst black people about the Arawaks and the Caribs, that the reason why the Arawak population was lessened in this part of the world was because they were eaten off. Lie, as usual, lie. Is Christopher Columbus and his friend them kill them off? Okay. On this wise, Columbus started to claim that major Indian tribes were brutal cannibals. This myth continues today. However, the anthropologist W. Ahrens recently documented that there was never any evidence that the Caribs ate human flesh regularly for food, or any of them. At this time, the European feudals were roasting. This is serious thing, you know. Meanwhile, Columbus was spreading the doctrine of cannibalism amongst the Caribs. In Europe, they were roasting their own in the marketplaces. People, I want you to listen to these things, you know. This is not Muta Baruka story, you know. This is his story. That Muta Baruka is his story. H-I-S-S-T-O-R-Y. His story, this. It's not me writing these stories. You understand? These stories is documented. Meanwhile, Christopher Columbus was spreading the doctrine of cannibalism amongst the Caribs. Over in Spain and Europe in general, they were roasting people at the stake in the name of Christianity. Seriously. At this time, the European feudals were roasting scientists, women, and peasant rebels alive in the marketplace of Europe. But their agent Columbus decided to portray the Indians as man-eating beasts to justify killing any of them that opposed the European invasion. The Spaniards established a settlement on the island Columbus called Espanola. This is the island where Haiti and the Dominican Republic are today. In the 1490s, it already had an Arawak name Pasquea. Unluckily for the native peoples there, this was one island which actually had traces of gold mixed in the sand of a few riverbeds. And we must know that even though they were searching for gold, Columbus did not find any money for gold. And we're going to show you how these people claiming that these natives were barbaric show more barbarianism than the people who them come find. We know that. We know that, you know. It says, Governor Columbus announced new orders. Listen to the orders I'm saying out now. Each Arawak man and woman over 14 years old would be required to bring a quarter of gold to the conquistadors every 3 months. This is the order now, you know. After the man come from the people, them land, you know, ask him no question, him joke flagging at the land, him come a sentence bay, where them call Discovery Bay. I don't know why them call it Discovery Bay. I mean, I know why them call it Discovery Bay, but I don't say why it should be called Discovery Bay. Because I'm sure never discover me. Christopher Columbus juke a flag, Spain flag in his sand. Now ask the people them no question. And claim said this is in the name of King and Queen of Spain. This land belongs to Spain. Never ask the people them nothing, you know. Never ask the people them a thing. They don't set up a law now. For the people them now, that's okay now. Every woman and man over 14 years old is required to bring a quarter of gold to the conquistadors every 3 months. Those who did wore a copper token around the neck. So anyone who bring in this quarter, you know, was what do you call now? Paid. A copper token around the neck. Those who could not pay the tribute had their hands cut off and their noses slit. I wonder the people them here with us a while ago. These are the things they never tell you in history class. That when any Arawak that did not live up to this quota that Columbus set, his hands were cut off and their noses slit, most bled to death. Now, I want to tell the people them this. This is something that them never teach in history class. In the Congo, serious thing, in the Congo, in the Belgium, when Leopold and his friend them went to the Congo, and I have pictures of these things. This is not painting now. This is not a painting like Jesus painting. This is actual photographs that is taken by these white people. Because they never see it as no big thing to do these things. And we're going to show you how barbaric these people is when them claim the Africans barbaric. Just the other day, 1492, these things was happening. 500 years ago, these things was happening in Europe and then spread it in other people's country. Now, in the Congo, this guy, King Leopold of Belgium, I have pictures where you see Africans walking around with no wrist. Some of them cannot walk because them foot part get chopped off. As a matter of fact, I have a picture, not painting. There's a difference between a picture and a painting. Where people have know these things. Michelangelo is a painting. Leonardo da Vinci is a painting. We're talking about picture that we take with camera. I have a picture of a Congolese who has him own hand in him other hand. Him wrist, them chop off your wrist. Just like with Columbus do years from now with the slave them. With the Taínos them. Chop off them wrists because they never bring gold. This was a practice. This was a practice by Europeans in a lot of African states, especially in the Congo. Yes, especially in the Congo. And Columbus did it here in the so-called Caribbean. Chop off the people them wrists and slit them nose. what barbarism, and them come to tell we, say, we barbaric. There were no wealthy gold fields on the island, so soon the Indians had given up their few gold chipettes and had to flee into the mountains, where they were systematically hunted down and killed. The Spanish priest, de las Casas, describes how the invaders, quote, grew more conceited every day, unquote, and after a while refused to walk. They, listen to this, you know, listen to these things, you know, these things that I'm not going to tell you in history class. Black History Month coming up, we starting our Black History Month right now. And after a while, refused to walk. These are the invaders, you know, this is one of them own, you know, it's not black people writing these things, you know, it's white people writing these things about white people. All right. And white people don't tell lie on white people. You understand? It's only black people tell lie on black people. White people don't not tell lie on white people. Okay. The Spanish priest, de las Casas, describes how the invaders, quote, grew more conceited every day, unquote. And after a while, refused to walk. They, quote again, this is quoting de las Casas, you know, rode the back of Indians if they were in a hurry, unquote, or were carried on hammocks by Indians running in relays. The first Spanish account of a sexual encounter in the New World describes the rape of an Indian woman given by Columbus to one of his officers. Columbus gave an Indian woman, and I don't like calling Indian neither, you know, because I know white people, but them call the people them Indian, and none of them never come from India. Everywhere white people go, him call the people them Indian. Him go to Australia and call them Aboriginal Indian. Him go to America, North America, and call them Red Indian. Him come here and call them Arawak Indian, Carib Indian. Him go to Guyana, I'm a Meridian Indian. Everybody is Indian. That's why they have all West Indian and play cricket. And none of them is not Indian. Anyway. There was resistance and the Spanish crushed it. Arawaks were hanged 13 at a time. Quote, in memory of our Redeemer and his 12 apostles. Now listen to this, black people of Jamaica. It's white people write these things. And no one trusts in white people words. So I have to read these things. Natives, the Arawaks were hanged 13 at a time. You know why them hanged 13 at a time? In memory of our Redeemer and his 12 apostles. Unquote. Native chiefs were burnt slowly to death on heated iron rods. Their tongues were bound so death agonies would not keep Spaniards awake through the night. Their tongues were bound so them couldn't scream out to wake up the other Spaniards them during the night. Mass suicides began. Arawaks killed themselves and their children with cassava poison. De las Casas writes that the invaders, quote, thought nothing of knifing Indians by the tens and twenties and of cutting slices off them to test the sharpness of their knives. My gosh, what a judgment. Listen to this. De las Casas, the Spaniard De las Casas, write in his memoirs that nothing thought that the invaders, these Spaniards, thought nothing of knifing these Arawaks by the tens. And twenties, and of cutting slices off them to test the sharpness of their blades. That means they tell them one of them nice sharp. Them just grab an Indian and just slice him to see how sharp him knife him. In Columbus, Española, shops sold Indian flesh to feed dogs of war, to train them for the hunt. Listen to these stories. It's not Muta Baruka's story, it's his story. In Columbus, Española, we're talking about Española now, which is Haiti and the Dominican Republic together. It is saying here, shops in Columbus time sold Indian flesh to feed dogs of war to train them for the hunt. In other words, when them feed the dog the Arawak flesh, when them send out a dog out there, the dog know the difference between white flesh and Arawak flesh, so them don't make no mistake in who them going to catch and who them going to eat. That is what is happening in South Africa during the apartheid era. The doctor of death, and it came up into the courts. The doctor of death was inventing germs. This is not me saying this. Germs that could affect black people and leave white people. This is what the man them was doing. They were creating germs that could affect black people and not affect white people. This is what you call germ warfare. This is reality. This is happening right now. And we say a more barbaric way. When you say barbaric way, I mean a more gruesome. Imagine you can go into a shop and buy some flesh of a human being in order to feed your dog. What manner of people is this? In the 2 years Columbus was governor of Hispaniola, half of the native population died. Under these murderous conditions, no one knows precisely how many Indians originally lived on Hispaniola. One estimate says that there were 250,000 Arawaks in 1492, and perhaps 10,000 were still alive 20 years later. My gosh, eh? Today, the Minister of Tourism in the Dominican Republic, Fernando, this is long time, is promoting the island of Hispaniola as the land that Columbus loved. Did you know that there is a statue of Columbus right in front of the Marcos Garvey School in St. Anne? We are telling that story, people are mixed up and confused. Did you know that a statue of Columbus resides in St. Anne in front of the Marcos Garvey School? This is something. Okay. The methods of Columbus were soon applied wherever Europeans landed. Owens in Wright's quote, what Columbus did to the Arawaks of the Bahamas, Cortes did to the Aztecs of Mexico. And we know that anywhere them go, it's that them do. Anywhere them go, it's that them do. Them go into Mexico. Mexico was once Texas. Mexico was once the whole of California. Now, the Mexican then cannot go across the border of San Diego into California because they are illegal aliens. We say that time and time again. One of the people them who's listening to the Cutting Edge right now in Mexico to know that Muta Baruca will be performing in Mexico on the 17th of February. Alright, so putting in that advertisement. Muta Baruca coming your way right here in Mexico City on the 17th of February. Okay. What Columbus did to the Arawaks of the Bahamas, Cortes did to the Aztecs of Mexico, Pizarro did to the Incas of Peru and the English settlers of Virginia and Massachusetts, to Powhatans, and this is the Indians, the so-called red man. The next century in the Americas is known by the people and progressive scholars as the Great Dying, though it is really taught in bourgeoisie history. Yes. Course in schools, all right. It is impossible to know how many natives died in this period. The Spanish observer Bartolomeu de las Casas writes in 1552 that during half a century of Spanish invasion, over 50 million Indians had died throughout the Western Hemisphere. Listen to that, you know. 50 million Indians died throughout the Western Hemisphere. When the Europeans destroyed the two major Indian empires in the Americas, the Incas of the Andes and the Aztecs of Mexico, elaborate systems of waterworks and food distribution collapsed as well. The people starved. Diseases swept into areas where no white man had yet been. During the 1500s, there were as many as 14 epidemics of European diseases between the Rio Grande and Panama, and perhaps as many as 17 in the Andean region. Malaria, introduced by Europeans, swept through the tropical lowlands up and down the Western Hemisphere. Native communities lost between 50% and 90% of their people. Altogether, about two-thirds of the native people may have died, most without ever seeing a white man. For a century, Spaniards would often march into conquer a region only to find ruined villages and skeletons. One modern estimate says that in Mesoamerica alone, from the Rio Grande to Panama, the population fell from 25 million in 1492 to 1.5 million by the year 1650. Serious documentation this. Death by enslavement followed disease and conquest. Indian labor was worked to death in the Spanish quest for gold. Nicaragua alone lost in the first half of the 16th century an estimated 200,000 inhabitants to slave traders who sold their prey in the Caribbean islands. Panama and Peru, a slave force of 40,000 Native Americans worked the plantation of Brazil by 1560. All islands were depopulated. The Caribbean tribes of Caribs, Arawak, and Taino virtually disappeared. What a serious, serious slaughtering of humans. What a serious slaughtering. And them say, the people them, barbaric. That is really the illusion that them sell you all the while, you know. That we is barbaric and then civilized. But this is going on and killing people. And when they say we are killing ourselves, well, we are killing ourselves. They might kill me. I mean, we don't start killing nobody yet. It's a serious thing. And yes, I'm saying now, whole islands were depopulated. The Caribbean tribes of Caribs, Arawaks, and Tainos virtually disappeared. And enslaved people were brought in from the mainlands of the Americas and Africa. To justify this, Spanish writers developed a theory. Listen to the theory the people then start develop now. That the Caribbean Indians had proven to be, quote, weaker people, unquote, who could not adapt to the discipline of labor or the morality of Christianity. Imagine that now, because we never give heed to them slave labor. Them say we was weaker people, and true, we never have no Christian morality. Them say we are weaker people. When Columbus' ship, La Nina, returned in 1492, it brought enslaved Taino Indians back to Spain. Columbus' first voyage was also the first transatlantic transit in slaves. From the second Columbus expedition, 500 Indians were sent back to Spain as slaves. Now we always hear about the African slaves, you know. Now we are hear about the Indian slaves that were sent to Spain. And we tell you already that it's not every African slave came across the Middle Passage. Some went across the Sahara Desert and never even reached across this part of the Caribbean. And this taking slaves across the Sahara Desert is as gruesome as taking them across the Middle Passage, because we know of the Sahara Desert and the burning sand. And you can chain up a man to a next man and tie up a man to a next man, cross those sand, while using your shade of, you know, your mules and your this and that. Almost people die. We have 100 million dying across the Atlantic. How much of us died across the Sahara Desert? They might do not study upon that, but we need to do study on it. After this, we don't say so. When Columbus' ship, La Nina, returned in 1492, it brought enslaved Taino Indians back to Spain. Columbus' first voyage was also the first transatlantic traffic in slaves. From the second Columbus expedition, 500 Indians were sent back to Spain as slaves. Columbus wrote, quote, "Let us, in the name of the Holy Trinity, go on sending all the slaves that can be sold," unquote. After this, the genocide of Caribbean Indians was so rapid that by 1518, only 26 years after Columbus landed, a Spanish ship carried the first cargo of Africans direct from the Guinea coast to the Caribbean. The Spanish conquest of the Americas is inseparable from the transport of tens of millions of kidnapped African people into bondage. Serious, serious history. Serious, serious history. We need you to take a stock. Take a stock, black people. Take a stock. This is the cutting edge and RFS. As we say, we're going into Black History Month and we want to just gear you up. Just reminisce and just search. You know, it's very important that we read. You know, we always tell the people them that reading very important in the advancement of knowledge. If black people would read more and observe more, they would find themselves in a better position. You know, they say if you want to hide something from black people, put it in a book. It's true. My grandmother used to put money. My grandmother used to put money in our Bible and put it up because she knows that nobody that going to ever read that. Even unto this day, there remain struggles of African people that parallel biblical times. For example, the Berlin Conference of 1884 to 1885 was called by a confederacy of European nations to set boundaries dividing Africa across tribal lands and peoples. While smoking cigars and drinking brandy, European diplomats proceeded to carve up the African continent. There were no Africans present or in representation to dispute or contest their whimsical decisions. This is saying here now that at the Berlin Conference, you must know these things. There's a conference that was called in the Berlin Conference. Yes, and this is where they started to divide up Africa. In its present, when you look on the map of Africa today, what you see there is the Europeans' land mark, not the African landmark. Okay, it's really surprising to know that when you look on a place like Senegal, there is a country in Senegal that is not the same country, named Gambia. They call it Senegambia now. In Senegal, the language spoken there is French, but in Gambia, the language spoken there is English. But Gambia is just like a little country inside of Senegal. It's weird. When you go to the Cameroon, you know, we go to the Cameroon where the Germans them ravish the whole place. Then the French them come and ravish it. Then the English them come. In one town, as a matter of fact, in Cameroon alone, there's 200 and odd French. Yaoundé is the capital. When you go outside of Yaoundé now, you have one that is English. So in that country, in that what you call parish then, everybody there talk English. But if you go in the other parish, everybody there talk French. Now your family, you will have family in the English section that don't know the French in the French section. It's a weird phenomenon when you go there. You know, because the Cameroon was part of the, what you call the collection point of slaves, of Africans, I should say. The collection point. What you have is that Africans are come from different parts of Africa and then come bungle them up right there, so now. You have the different languages in, you know, in wanting to communicate. Different languages start to develop just right there, so alone, you know. So, 400 and add different languages in one country. It's a weird phenomenon that, you know. And it's not only weird, you know, but we must understand that the French and the English, which is the most spoken language in Africa right now, who give with the French and who give with the English? Who is the colonizers of these countries? That you can have a country in a country and one part of the country talk French and one part of the country talk English. This is all about the Berlin Conference. Numerous doctrines and philosophies have since been devised and employed to justify and validate this continuing exercise in global white superiority. What is called manifest destiny, the survival of the fittest, the white man's burden, and social Darwinism. The latter doctrine was crafted by Darwin's theory of evolution, placing whites at the top of the evolutionary scale, followed by those of yellow, brown, and black pigments in this scheme of things. Africans came in just above apes and monkeys. The bell curve was merely the latest version of this trend. Never before in history had so many nations gathered in one place, quite so brazenly to deliberate and agree upon the seizure of a whole continent and the treat as chattels with people and their estates. Every European country, with the exception of Switzerland, was there. Both the United States of America and the Ottoman Empire were also represented. Hung on the wall was a large map of Africa. The present-day boundaries of Africa and other regions of the world as drawn by the European colonial powers without a regard for pre-existing historical and ethnic differences have led to untold chaos, misery and suffering on the part of millions. That conference began in November 1884. Has come to be seen as the key moment in the history of the colonization of Africa. Soon after began the scramble for Africa and the partitioning of the continent was completed. This is what we call now the Berlin Conference. Berlin Conference divide Africa. Isn't it ironical? No, I mean the people don't even check things, you know. How is it that Egypt, listen to these realities now. This is realities now. We show you all these people is confused and then make we just as confused as them. How is it that Egypt is supposed to be in the northern part of Africa? When we look on the map, if you remember the map of Africa right now, Egypt is in the northeastern part of Africa. All right. Ethiopia is below Egypt. In other words, Ethiopia is south of Egypt. Because you have other countries in between Ethiopia and Egypt. And then below Ethiopia is even Uganda, which is even more southern of Egypt. Now, have you ever heard of a river flowing up? Have you ever heard of a river flowing up? Hear what these idiot people tell me now, that civilization went up the River Nile. Civilization starts from the top of the River Nile and went down the River Nile. Because if white people decide where is north, where is south, where is east, and where is west. This is not a divine thing that is happening here now. It's based upon of them.